I just want to show a video of our keynote that we made prior to her telling her story. So if someone can help me with the lights, and I'll get this video started. So if you want to bring your chair over here, I know we don't have like a big screen, so this is all I got. So.
They stood up with other non-gender conforming people that were tired of the police brutality. So to me, that's a very critical piece in history that many of the people that booked me seem to forget.
I knew that was a big risk to take, but to me, I've always been a risk taker. And the message and giving the voice to my community that don't have that voice was more important. Issue that is immigration, right? And you also add the layer of the transgender piece, and it just creates more division, more conflict, even within our own community. So I do want to acknowledge that yesterday we found out that another one of our sisters was shot in the head twice. So we lost another soul. Her name was Cecilia Leona, and she was only 21 years old. So let's take a moment to honor her life and also to remember those who are currently in detention centers suffering. Why get involved in activism? Why now? I believe that the more visible the transgender community is becoming, the more of a back backlash there is, but also there are a sector of the community who's being left behind or thrown under the bus, right? Because I'm already out to be trans, I'm already being out to be undocumented. Many people don't want to just listen to what I have to say. And they just believe that any kind of abuse, any kind of state violence that we're facing, we deserve it. We are breaking the law, we are, whatever, you know, any kind of labels they throw at us, it's even further dehumanizing our lives and our experiences and how we are also part of the community, right? So to me, that moment at the White House was very critical to say we can no longer stay quiet, we cannot tolerate any more oppression and any more violence. Look at the statistics so far in this year, at least 21 trans women, mostly of color and gender non-conforming people, have been murdered. And that's not including the suicide statistics that we have there. That's not including those who have survived some kind of attack, right, and harassment and things like that. So to me, coming into the U.S. was a very difficult decision. I grew up in a single mother home. My mom came from a very traditional Catholic conservative family that my grandmother took her out of school when she was three years old and said, you have to, you know, help me with the house chores. You have to kind of just be a housewife, basically. And my mother married her husband. They had six children through church, obviously. And then her husband moved to Tijuana with the promise to send money back home. And that, you know, assistance never came. So my mom started to struggle, right? And then my dad moved into the town where I was born in the state of Jalisco, started having a relationship with my mother, conceived three children. And my grandma was really upset about that, because you're not supposed to have children out of wedlock, right? Your role is to be committed to your husband for the rest of your life as the woman in a traditional home in Mexico. So I often tell people, like, I was already, you know, rejected before I was even born. And you can say that we could be the children of sin in a way, right? Because these are the values that the norms of society has on us. So we were struggling. We went to, it was a very difficult journey. It was painful coming to terms with who I am. But as it was becoming more difficult for opportunities back home in our country, our brothers and sisters started to make their way into the U.S. and finding employment and sending money back home until finally all of us settled in. Only my mom and her nine children. The rest of my uncles and aunts are back home. So it was in Mexico is when I started to explore my sexual orientation. I've always felt an attraction for men ever since I'm aware of my existence. And also I started to know there was something wasn't aligning with my mind and my body. So I started to explore my gender identity in Mexico, dressing up and things like that. Finally, in the U.S., I connected with a group of Latino friends that I hung out, and we started to dress up on the weekends. My family knew, but they were just kind of, you know, like, no, we can't really support that lifestyle. It's an embarrassment to the family. What are people going to say? It goes against any beliefs that we have. So, but I still continue to explore that. And during that process, because I couldn't embrace who I was, I started to drink heavily, I started to use drugs and doing these kinds of things to numb the pain, right? Or that this rejection that I felt. And it was only 3 years ago when I said, I can't take anymore. I got on the call and told my mom, my sister, you know, I am depressed. I have to, you know, transition. I realize fully now that I am a transgender woman. And in order to do that, I have to make the transition into the gender that I identify. And to my surprise, she was really supportive at that point. And then I told my mom, I told my brothers and sisters, because I felt that was my responsibility. And it was their responsibility to educate their children. However, they wanted to approach the subject, but it was something that needed to be talked about, because at that point it was obvious that they weren't going to turn their back on me, that they were going to embrace Jensen as a member of the family and support me and love me as I am. So living in LA during this time, I finally when I was taking some classes in college, I started to become political conscious of the social injustices that the immigrant community is facing, that the transgender community is facing, so much harassment, so much discrimination, so much violence, right? And to me, I met wonderful activists in LA, and I said I had to do something for my community. So I started participating in demonstrations in LA with Bambi Faustino, who formed the Translatina Coalition, the Hija Familia Transqueer Liberation Movement, who collaborated, and in November 2014, I participated in my first direct action of civil disobedience in LA, and that was to bring awareness of the violence that transgender women are facing in this country. And this year, in 2015, the number is an alarming high. It's one of the highest we've had in the nation. So those are the issues that were, you know, drawing me into activism. So that was just my identity piece. And now we had the immigration side that I was hiding for so long and don't want to disclose it because I was afraid of any retaliation by employment, or I was afraid that if I disclose that information to someone in my circles, they can call, you know, immigration and start the deportation process. So when I started to find out how trans women and queer people in general were being treated inside these detention centers, the very first thing, and this is where it really kills me, right? Like, a group of people are going through so much discrimination, so much oppression, but the moment you mention you're undocumented or you lack the documents, they already turn their back on you, not realizing that they are facing, refusing to make the connections of oppression that we're facing, right? And I don't want to like come and beg you to support or get behind our movement, because we are already doing the movement, right? And we're going to stand up and fight back. We're not going to, just because you are part of the community and you don't disagree, or you just strongly disagree, it's not going to hold me back. It's going to fuel me more and continue to work harder. But at least have the decency to listen to what we have to say. And you see the community in DC, my own LGBT community, is going to be celebrating how much progress, yet they seem to forget the most marginalized, right? And that goes with the transgender population in general and the LGBTQ currently in detention centers. So to me, that was a moment to, you know, after going through this journey in life with all these experiences, with all this pain and anxiety that I was facing, perhaps those who are privileged to have been born in this part of the land will never experience. They will face some other kind of discrimination, some kind of harassment, but it would never relate to or come close to the way we undocumented people feel or face, and on top of that, our sexuality and with our gender identity. So hopefully with this, we continue to, with this interruption that I'm sure many of you heard, that the debate and something that many activists in the on their own community were trying to show the rift that exists in the LGBT community and how they just put so much emphasis on a specific issue, taking so many resources, and the rest of the problems that we're facing, they're secondary. And if we even get to you, we'll get to you, right? But we're saying we can wait. We cannot continue for our sisters to be killed. We cannot continue for our sisters to be discriminated against, so we needed to raise our voice. Raise my voice, and with that I raised the voice of the community. Going into the White House, it was, as an activist, it was intentional. I wasn't gonna go and celebrate, pretend like everything was gonna be okay, especially being already active in LA with my community, knowing and hearing the testimonies of two Guatemalan transgender women who were inside detention centers with both Nicole and Jessica, with both sharing similar treatment. One, the misgender, the sexual and physical abuse, and if they dare to complain to the ICE official, they were put in the, to me, is one of the most horrendous punishments we can do to any human being, and that's solitary confinement. You know, you isolate the individual from any human contact, even in their, in these horrible places, and that adds more trauma to their experience, even if it's for a day. It already has an implication. So when you're released, you're facing with a totally new set of challenges to reintegrate and really contribute. And that's basically what we all seek in this country, right? To give that opportunity to thrive and survive. But obviously the statistics show differently. You know, it's just, it was, to me, it was the moment of truth. It was the moment to challenge myself and say everything that I came through, I have to no longer hide it. I can no longer let that be a shame in my journey. And no matter how much privilege I gain, I should never forget my community, and I will continue to fight back until the end for our liberation. Thank you.